Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery, the Let's Play where you get to, well, help choose what happens next in the story. So we are here at this mansion. You rap three times. After a short wait, an elderly man in a gown opens the door with a strange spiky lizard creature winding around his legs. Yes, he demands. And who are you? You look like a trustworthy sort. It was unanimous. Well, I got 4 likes on the video. Last video. 2 votes. for the same thing. I guess the other people didn't want to vote because they felt they couldn't beat the 2 votes. But anyway, both said that I should say I'm from the council. So I'm from the council. You lie. Oh, tax ban, is that it? The man exclaims with juicy annoyance. Come to rob me? He pets the lizard at his feet, clearly threatening you. I wasn't impressed by that. Please, I need your help. You certainly look like a drowning dog, he remarks coolly. You have angered him, and he no longer wants to talk. The man slips back and snaps a command at his pet. Ericius? Attack! The creature is a bristled beast, and it comes leaping forward for your throat, jaws snapping. Give the man my sword. Fight the creature. Let's try to... Charm animal. Damn it. Wait, no, that's a Z. Charm animal is law, not available. These are G's, I can't cast giant form either, because we don't have B. I'm still technically outside, so it's not an enclosed space, right? But not available. Web? Let's try web. Requires a vial of glue. Oh, we don't have it. Huh. You try to bind the enchantment, but you're missing an item that it needs, and so the spell dissipates around you. Damn, I keep doing that. The lizard snaps its jaws. You draw your sword. Well, it's snapping its jaws, so let's just defend right now. I don't have a lot of stamina. The bristled beast bares its teeth, and the spines on its back spike up. Bleed this intruder, Lorag commands him lazily. Oh, so it's Lorag. You pace back from the creature, sword raised. Then the creature charges, jaws wide for your neck. Then the bristle beast's spines bend. It's about to do something. But what? I'm going to defend again. Oh, nothing. You keep your sword raised, expecting to be rushed. The bristle beast hunkers down too. Alright, I'm going to make a powerful... Readying your sword, you attack, charging forward across the corridor, biting for blood. As the bristle beast swings its head, only to catch your blade more deeply, it staggers as you wound it. Let's go again. Damn, 2 at a time, like it. You batter at the bristle beast. Backed up against the wall, you can barely swing your sword, but you muster all your strength as it tries to bash you back. The beast dribbles and cries and is a pitiful wail. Ah, it won this time. Then the bristle beast charges in return. You swipe with your sword, but its spines enter your skin and bury themselves deep. Its head is pulled back. Nice. I'm going to defend this time. Well, nothing. You drop your guard down low. The bristle beast has dropped low. Takes care of that. Leveling your blade, you strike, cutting the bristle beast down. With the final swing, you bury your blade deep into the bristle beast. It twists on the metal, then curls up like an overheated beetle and dies. 3 stamina loss, rough going. Oh, Throth's collar, swears Lorag. Well, why don't you tell me what you want? You are a noble of the city? You ask. I was the 4th. I retired. I'm lucky to have done it, too. I need to know the spell lines. For the North Gate, you say. I am sorry. You will tell me willingly, or you will tell me in your dying breath. Why, I didn't want to say all that. The scholar nods. Or I will tell you a lie, and you will not know it until the guards come to haul you into the dungeons, and from there you will curse my name. Please, I am an intelligent man, and I perceive you are an intelligent woman. You can hurt or kill me, but you cannot learn what I will not teach you. So I say again, go. Well, I can go, draw my sword, or cast a spell. Can I... Hold on. Cloth skull cap is for telepathy? Yeah, let's read his mind. If we can't read his mind, I will be very put off. T. E. L. Yes. I have the skull cap, dammit. You cast a spell. The scholar watches you cautiously, expecting some kind of attack. But when nothing seems to change, he relaxes a little, and then you begin to hear his thoughts. He doesn't think much of you, that much is clear. You nod your head and turn to leave. He shows you the door. Who's been updated? Now, I wonder if we had told him something else, if he would have reacted more favorably towards us, and we wouldn't have lost 3 stamina. Well, let's look at clues. 4th Noble Lorag is a scholar, and also... 4th Noble and also a scholar. Wait. We haven't found out the spell line. Return to the main road. Yeah, I hate to do this, but I'm afraid we're never gonna get out of this town. I'm gonna rewind. Sorry, guys. I'm gonna tell him, I'm gonna try this, that I'm just a traveler. I see. A beggar, you mean. He pats a lizard at his feet, clearly relaxing in your company somewhat. Okay. Please, I need your help. He sighs. It seems you have placated him. I'm sorry to be rude. In this city, you have to be careful. For every savior you meet, there's a Van Gorn waiting to slit your throat wide open. Please, will you come in? Push past him. Thank you. This isn't the way I normally play games. I'll just continue on. But maybe in this sort of game, you have to rewind and try different things. Just food for thought. I don't know. Thank you. The old man gestures for his spiny lizard pet to retreat. Step aside, Eritius, and let the stranger in. Okay, we actually get to go in the house, so this is worth it. I don't like redoing things, but this is worth it. You step inside his house. The walls are decorated with ornate hangings, and on the walls are numerous curious artifacts. The man turns to you. Before you enter further, please, hand me your weapon. Sure. not thrilled about it, but the man accepts your sword and places it on a table by the door. "Come in, then," he says, putting out his hand. "My name is Lorag the Elder, and I am a scholar and a sage." He gestures you further into the house. "This way, please." Now, isn't the guy at the gate, isn't that also Lorag? Here? Or here, whatever. Ooh, look at all this stuff, see? Follow him. It's the only way to go. You follow him into his study, an elegant room lined floor to ceiling with books. We could look around. I could tell him I overheard a plot. Ask him if he's a sage or sorcerer. Ask about the North Gate. I have met your ghost. Hopefully you can look around first and then do other things. You glance around at the shelves lined with hundreds of volumes on magic, maps, learning, weaponry, falconry, carpentry, and every other subject you can imagine. The only gap in the shelving is for the painting of a young man. Lorag himself, perhaps, though it does not look like him, and the line below reads Crescenti. The scholar's pet is whining around his leg. He ruffles its spines absently. "There, Iritius," he murmurs, "there's a good beast." "Yes, and in an alternate reality, I killed that beast." I definitely do want to ask him about the North Gate and the ghost. But let's see, ask him about the painting. You point at the painting. "Who is that?" Lorag scowls at you. "Have you come to make conversation, or have you come with a true purpose?" The old man seems to have a thought, and goes over to a cupboard, taking out two glasses. "Some wine while we talk?" "Sure." "Oh, nice! We got 4 stamina back." You nod your head and he pours you a glass. It is rich, delicately flavored, and warms you to your guts. So are you a sage or a sorcerer? He laughs. "Neither. I am a teacher, a scholar, but I like to think of myself as wise enough, and when I have studied books, I have studied sorcery. I seek to understand how it came to be, for it is the beginning of something that determines its true power." The scholar seats himself and steeples his fingers. "How does a man of learning survive?" "You can't be at home among such ruffians as fill the streets of Kharé." He laughs. "The city isn't as bad as all that, or, well, perhaps it is, but in every city where there are children, there's a need for people who teach children." He shrugs. "I teach the best lock-picking class in town. In a way, I'm a pillar of things here." I'm gonna go right to this, then. "I have met your ghost," you tell him with great glee. "He haunts the north gate of this city. He claims to have founded the city as well." Why am I telling him with great glee? "A most curious notion," the wizard replies, not dismissing your remark. "I have often thought there are aspects of this city's design that are just as I would have chosen it. I will think on it, stranger, believe me." "Yes, about the north gate. I am told you can help me open the north gate." He looks at you seriously. "You are on a mission, I see that. But is your mission to destroy Kharé, or to save it?" "I will save it. I will save all the lands. I am a mission to retrieve the Crown of Kings." The scholar nods deeply. "It is a good mission. For such a mission, they would send a powerful fighter, and a great sorcerer. Let me see." And he goes over to his bookshelf, returning with a paper folder. "You know, of course, how magic comes to be in this world?" "No." "Magic comes from the stars." "Well, that's true, yeah. The stars above create the power and the force that sorcerers channel for their work. And so the powers that are available are determined by the stars, not by the form of the spells themselves." "Go on." I am a humble scholar, but the question I have set my life to answering is this. Are there other ways for magic to be wrought? You mean other kinds of magic? No, not other kinds, only other forms. Here, I will show you. He opens the folder and spreads out several sheets of rough paper across his desk. They contain a pattern of strange symbols grouped in threes. Okay. So... Just trying to look at these. Look like a spear. Looks some kind of cross with a circle in the middle. This looks a cross with two circles. Kind of looks like a space invader. And you've got these little tie things. These were discovered painted on the walls of the Dadule caves, he explains. I have paid handsomely to have them smuggled to me. Even the first noble of Kharé does not know I have them, and if he did, his rage would be terrible. Do you know what they are? Tell me. He grins excitedly. They are spells, but not spells as we would have them. These were painted by cave people before the Dark Ages, over 3,000 years before Chelanna discovered the crown. They perform the same magic because the stars have not changed, but as you can see, the spells themselves are different. See this one? And he draws out a sheet of paper on which is drawn these symbols. An upside down L, kind of like a T with a 1 underscore and a W. What does it do? We will never be completely sure, he replies. He shakes his head. But based on the images found with this spell, I believe it is a spell of confusion, one that will muddle and befuddle any creature over whom it is cast. We know a similar magic now, of course, but the incantation has changed. Huh. I believe I know it. I know the similar magic, yeah. If that's what you mean. Is that so? He laughs. Then please, do not cast it on me. I am quite muddled and befuddled already. He moves the paper aside and brings out another, which is painted... You guys can look at that. What do you make of this one? He asks. I don't freaking know. I guess I'm supposed to look at my spells. Looks like I've got an upside down G, an upside down Q. Is that a W? Am I supposed to be getting these right to impress him or something? So let me try to get them right. If I'm supposed to read it back to front, well, we don't have a lot of J spells, that's for sure. Something ending in J? Maybe it's the wall spell. W-A-L. Invisible wall. Well, protection. A spell of protection. Lorag shakes his head. No, that is not correct. Such spells existed, of course, but this is not one of them. He looks at you expectantly. Alright, so it's not... I'm supposed to puzzle this out somehow? What else starts with a W? Got walk, which is metal shield. W-A-L I did. What else is W? Not a whole hell of a lot. But this one, the tech, yeah, I don't think it's tech. That's the one I discovered. Well, I don't know, should I just blindly guess? healing, mind reading. We already did confusion, right? So I'm thinking either healing or mind reading. Mind reading is T-E-L. And I don't know a spell of healing. We really don't. We have wizard spells. We don't have, like, clerical type spells. Gonna guess mind reading? Quite right. Lorag claps his hands. Well then, I see you truly are a sorcerer. So I guess it's similar to the T-E-L? U, V, W, and then E. F. Wait. Oh no. F, G, J, K, L. They're all like two or three letters apart. So if you got T, E, L, if that's a G. Here then is my puzzle. He reaches over for another folder and opens it slowly and cautiously, as though the contents might try to bite him. I'm gonna wait. He lays a sheet out on the desk. This spell was found inside one of the deepest caves, a place so old and ancient it had never been revisited since the time when these people set their home fires all across the Shamutanti Hills. The painting inside is indicated that this was their most powerful, most terrible magic. But as you see, the spell is partly lost. You understand his meaning. On the page are drawn two symbols, not three. The last symbol is unreadable. The scholar leans in, urgently. A rockfall destroyed part of this picture, but dearly, I wish to know, what was the last character? So that is a G. Damn it. It's similar, because that's the same as this. So if that's an E, a spell of confusion. That's an M. W is M then. That's not really a W, that's a screwed up W. This really isn't helping me either. Is that his lizard creature? Up there? Okay. So the only repeat character I see is this, which I guess is E. Because for T-E-L... So it's something E. And the N... let me look. So what has an E in the middle? For the middle letter. I might not even be right. I don't even know. Just trying to not miss anything here. So other than Tal, of course, which you've already seen. We have Pep, which is a super strength. So unless we have another N, N-E-N, or N-Q-N, what, N-G-N, whatever. Or it could be levitate, which is also N, ends in N. Well, no, that would be, it's Pep, P-E-P. Or Z-E-N. That'd be a different character. Or it could be R-E-S Resurrection. or Z, the mystery spell. The mystery spell, yeah, says it's the most powerful. And I have it written down. I'll just show you guys. Let's just go all the way to the back. This is the most formidable spell in lore, but no one knows why. In all recorded history, this spell has been cast only once by a powerful necromancer from Throbin, who was never seen again. Its effects are unknown. The necromancer's notes were found, but were crazed and unclear. Treat with extreme caution. So that sounds like what it is. Zed. So this is a Z. Then that's an E. And whatever I have is a D. A spell of confusion, which is dim, right? Yeah, see, the thing is, it's Zed, but I don't know what the D character is. I believe I know. He nods. Never taking his eyes from your face, he hands you a fresh sheet of paper and a quill. Draw it for me, he says. Zed. Unless we're backwards. I don't know why I'm automatically thinking it's backwards. Let's see if there's anything else he says. Krypton threes. So this is confusion, which confuse is dim. Oh, dim. So we want this upside down L character is D. Holding the brush with arm outstretched as you were taught, you draw the symbol upside down L. The scholar considers for a long time, breathing through his thick beard. Then he nods deeply. Yes, I do believe you have it. He looks up. Do you know the spell? I know of it. He nods. I see you are truly a great sorcerer. This spell is one I have only heard rumor of. I have never seen the constellation that lies behind the magic. But this will help me in my search. Yes, I think it will help a great deal. He files away his pages, taking the one with your drawing on with particular care. Now, I may aid you in return. You wish to learn the spell for the North Gate. I don't mind giving you my line, although it is my secret to keep. He tells you his line, and you nod. It is as if you have already been told. Where can I find the other lines? He shakes his head. The keepers of the lines are all leading citizens, but where they are, I do not know. At least one of them, Shinva, is dead. But I have heard it said he still haunts his tomb in the necropolis. But please, before you go, follow me. He gestures across the room to a bookshelf lined with artifacts. Well, I'm not going to leave. That would be stupid. I want goodies. Give me artifacts. You follow him across the room. He opens a drawer in a tall cabinet and pulls out something that looks like a shock of green fur. The green wig. Put this on for me, if you would, he says. I wish to try an experiment. Okay, we found someone wearing the green wig way back in, like, the fair. I forget the name of it. It's on the other side of the river. When we first not first, when we first came into the city, and then we ended up in jail cell and some back alleys and stuff, but we ended up at this fair, and this guy was wearing a green wig. Now the green wig, I can see here, it is a spell component for speak with person or speak with animal, rap or yap spells, respectively. So he wants to put it on. We should try an experiment. What kind of experiment? Oh, it is quite harmless, Lorag says. Just a little thing I found in my calculations. I suspect it will not work. I'm going to take the wig. Hopefully we get to keep it. He's going to try to read our mind, or I'm going to try to read his mind, I guess. You take the fur and find it is, in fact, a green wig. Now, Lorag says, put it on. He is pulling something from his own pocket as he speaks, what looks like a skull cap made of white cloth. Well, I have a skull cap, which is used for the TEL spell. Let's put on the wig. You pull the wig over your head, feeling quite ridiculous. Lorag smiles and puts the white skull cap on his own head. Then he begins to cast a strange-sounding spell, speaking in syllables that sound more like goblin than the ancient tongue of magic. Should I cast a spell back at him? T-E-L? Begin to cast a spell, taking the skull cap from your pack and placing it on your head. Did we put it over the wig? Lorag stops his own incantation immediately. Please, he smiles. You are interrupting my experiment. Let's apologize and remove the skull cap. You apologize and remove the skull cap once more, not catching any of his thoughts in the process. Oh, I don't think I used any stamina, which is good. Slowly and carefully, Lorag completes a spell. You feel his thoughts reaching out and entering your mind, projecting strange ideas and curious images. Somehow, the wig is letting him talk to you, but not in a human tongue, but one of the many other tongues of Kakabad. Suddenly you drop to your knees. I'm gonna take the thing off. You lift one hand, then proceed to scratch your elbow. Lorag laughs and claps his hands in delight. Superb, he remarks. Simply marvelous. Remove the wig. You bark twice in reply, turn around, and then sit at Lorag's feet. Quite incredible, you hear him remark, and then he says something further in the common tongue, but for some reason you cannot understand it. In fact, you see nothing but his eyes. They fill your gaze. He has produced a stick. All of a sudden I do not trust this guy for crap. He turned me into a dog or something. Well, mentally. You open your mouth and take the stick between your teeth. Lorag beams, claps his hands, and makes a gesture that causes you to stand. You follow him out of the door. You have become a sorcerer's pet. Your adventure is at an end. What? Oh, come on now. We have to do... Okay. I'm gonna not take the wig. I have to be going, you tell him, refusing his offer. Of course, he nods. Well, thank you for the company. Lorag shows you the door, and you retrieve your sword as you go. I wish we could take the wig. Wait, did he actually tell us a spell line? Wait. Oh, the priest and... Is this new? I don't remember this. The priest at the Shrine of Slaying might be able to help you find the spell lines to the gate. The shrine is located between the well and the docks in Lower Kharé. I don't think we know anything then when we before we came in here. Where's this shrine? On the other side? I'm wondering how long the other chapters are going to be. Wow. I didn't expect this to go on for so, like, even half as long as us. The first chapter was so quick. Huh. The road continues on between dense houses on either side, when suddenly you begin to smell a sharp, acrid smell. Burning. Looking up ahead, you see a column of smoke. Is the district on fire? Push onwards. I'm not sure what I cast a spell for now. You stride forwards, rounding a corner in the road until you can see the source. It is a fire, but not a blazing house. Instead, it comes from an enormous forge set into a large blacksmith shop. The blacksmith himself is at work, hammering away at a flat-bladed sword. I don't think we got that guy's spell line, because it's not added to clues. You approach the blacksmith and try to attract his attention by waving, but it seems the blacksmith is quite deaf. Years of hammering on sparking metal has left him quite oblivious to everything around him. I think he would see if we try to steal something, so let's tap his arm. You walk over and tap his arm, and the blacksmith jumps. Didn't see you there, he bellows too loudly. The man is clearly not that bright. Sorry, guys. I didn't mean to scare you. Not scarred? The blacksmith replies hotly. Me? Of you? Nah. The blacksmith polishes his blade lovingly. Wolf armor. Do you make wolf armor? You ask, thinking about the strange werewolf you saw. The blacksmith looks at you with fierce cold eyes. Vic for First Noble, he replies. But says nothing more. I know who Vic is. So I don't have much information on Vic, so let me ask him. Who is Vic? He's the boss, blacksmith replies. Has been for a long time. Just making it official. Huh. Tell me about your swords. This one is my finest, he replies proudly, indicating the blade he is currently polishing up. A blade of large hand. Large hand. Large hand, the blacksmith agrees. It's large handry. Try the blade. You reach out to try the blade, but the blacksmith catches your arm. I warn you, he says, once you have tried it, you won't want any other. And it's not a cheap blard. I'll risk it. The blacksmith shrugs and releases your arms. Your arm. Go on, then. You pick up the blade and swing it through the air. It sings. The weight is perfect, the metal sharpened, the balance so delicate it becomes almost an extension of your arm. This is the finest blade you have ever held. How much? Oh, God. The blacksmith grins. I told you. Ready for it? 40 gold pieces. 40? The blacksmith nods. That's right, 40. I only have 12 gold. I don't have that much. The blacksmith nods and takes the blade back with loving care. It'll find its owner sooner enough, I'm sure. The blacksmith quickly hammers something. The noise makes your head spin. I'm interested in a North Gate spell. He's not going to know that. Really? He has something? I make swords? He replies. Oh, swords. With a shrug. Not magic. You want a sword, maybe? The blacksmith goes over to the back of his shop and downs a quick mug of ale. I'd best do work, he says as he returns. Be gone. Then he begins to hammer so loudly you fear for your hearing, so you quickly run out of the shop. What kind of clue do we have? Wait. Vic for First Noble. The inhabitants of Kharé are greeting each other with the slogan Vic for First Noble. Huh. Let's continue up the road. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. You walk between the narrow buildings and reach a fork. To the left, the road continues towards some kind of bustling market, while to the right it leads down a shorter street. In the center of the fork, the bronze statue is back on its pedestal once more. Look at the statue. The statue is of a giant brute wielding a club, and at its feet is a large pot filled with gold pieces. This must be one of Kharé's many gods, with the pot intended for worshippers making offerings, although none of the passing creatures seem to be throwing any in. Huh? Can we do it again? Let's look down the short street. Looking down the short street to the right, you see a sign above a doorway reading, The Gambling Halls of Vlada. Several seedy-looking creatures mill about on the steps. Cheerful creatures go in, and miserable-looking ones come out. Yeah, I'm not gonna mess with that. Time to move on. I'm tempted, you know. But I think... Well, let's see if we can buy some rations or something. I want to go... I'm not going to mess with the statue again. I feel that would be really greedy. I want to go here eventually. This is a gambling. Let's go here really quick. See if we can get some kind of provisions. We've seen this before. Wait. We can't go. The day is trying on, huh? Yeah. Okay, never mind. I guess we've been to those already. We can't buy anything there at those stalls. So let's try this. You follow the road to a wide open space laid out for a market. There are several stalls, all selling the same goods, their traders arguing loudly over who has the cheapest or the best quality. Provisions, weapons, useful gear, magic items. Buy a well. Well, we need food. Browsing the stalls, you find that the food is reasonably expensive, with the cheapest provisions being sold at 3 gold pieces each. One trader is also selling a wrap package of 6 meals worth for 15 gold pieces, but you do not have enough for that. Three gold pieces each? Buy 2 meals. You hand over 6 gold pieces and place the provisions into your pack, and then move away into another area of the market. Okay, good. What can you do? We haven't found food for quite a while. So, let me just... Yeah, there's standard meals. Okay. Let me look at useful gear. You browse around stalls selling useful gear and items for travelers and come across one thing which might be useful. The first is a tinderbox for lighting fires, though it will not work without tinder, and the second is a bottle of snake bite antidote. The tinderbox costs 2 gold pieces and the antidote 3. Don't I still have the tinderbox? Or was that one of the things I lost? Yeah, I have it. Okay. Now, we came across a snake here, and we didn't need venom. We were pretty much okay. We just fought it normally, so I'm gonna buy nothing. You turn on a trader and move on to the market. I'm probably not gonna buy any weapons. Let me just look. You take a turn about the armorer's stalls. Mostly what is on sale is of poor quality or weaker than the blade you already carry, but 2 things catch your eye: a hefty broadsword with a good solid grip, and a bow with a quiver of silver-tipped arrows. Test the broadsword. Silver-tipped arrows for werewolves. I'm gonna test both. You lift the broadsword and slice it through the air. Perfectly balanced, enthuses the sword maker. Not an antique either, but made brand new. 8 gold pieces. You judge the blade to be well awaited. Well, if you hadn't bought food, we could have got it. Let's test the bow. You lift the bow and test the string. It seems firm and responsive, and although you have little use for ranged weapons, this one seems hardy enough. The quiver is interesting. It contains 10 arrows, but each has a tip made not of steel, but pure silver. The armorer nods at you significantly as you discover this. For you know what? No. The dead. Only silver can pierce the hearts of the dead. Then he adds in a whisper, 6 gold pieces. Okay. So I can get this and head for the necropolis. I hate doing it because that's all our money. But maybe we'll find greater riches down there. What do you guys think? Okay. This is where I'm stopping. Gone far enough. What do you guys think? Should I buy the bow, using up all our gold, which we won't be able to buy or do anything else? There's other sections in the game in which you can do things with gold, like to throw a gold piece in something or to buy more rations or something we might need further down the line, which we do not know yet. So what do you think? Put your comments in the, comment section. Should I blow the rest of my gold for this bow and then head back for the necropolis? Of course, that's probably where I'm going to be using it. Who knows, it might be useful against the werewolves as well, although he hasn't said so. It's a good thing I told him no. He might not have, told us so. So there's ramifications for both. I mean, maybe we can skip buying this and we can fight, I'm assuming Shinva at his tomb. You know, fight him in more mundane ways with my sword. So what do you guys think? The bow or the gold? So yeah, it's the bow or the gold. That's it. That's the only 2 choices. That's the only ones I'm counting. Of course, there's different ramifications of this. We might be able to come back and buy the bow later, although you know this game, it's tricky to come back to places, although we can probably rewind and just make our way back here anyway. Maybe when we have more gold, hopefully. So, yeah. Gold or the bow? Your money or your bow? Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode and endure. In enduring, grow strong.